When the order first came down, I was stunned. I was shocked. It just struck me as wrong. How could they do that to me? How could they ask me to swear an oath of loyalty to America and then expect me to turn around and forget about that oath by putting on someone else's uniform?
Michael New decided to approach his commanding officer.
I went to my commander, and I told my commander, very simply, I took an oath to defend the Constitution of the United States of America against all enemies, foreign and domestic. My Army enlistment oath is to the Constitution, and in that oath, I cannot find any reference to the United Nations.
Specialist New was court-martialed for refusing to wear the UN uniform.
Michael New's case is the first time where there's a real test of the sovereignty of the United States of America in a way that positions the Constitution against internationalist thinking. And the question is, does the United States government have to obey the laws of the United States in the area of deploying our troops? And I think it's a very important question that we answer.
Well, what I now know is that just because you join the U.S. Army doesn't necessarily mean that you'll be fighting for the U.S.
What troubles me about this is that there is a general tendency, I think, on the part of our leadership, and it isn't, again, just this administration, although it's reached kind of a crescendo in this administration, that we need to submerge the goals and the sovereignty of the United States to the goals and the sovereignty of the United Nations. I think that there's a real question here about the sovereignty of the United States.
The Michael New case exposed the plan to transform American troops into a United Nations army. And the American people are simply not going to put up with that. So now the advocates of global governance have come up with a new plan. A treaty to expand NATO will soon be submitted to the U.S. Senate. If it is ratified, it means that American sons and daughters will be obliged to defend the current borders of Poland, Hungary, Czechoslovakia, Romania, Slovenia, and all the other countries that join NATO in the future. Those countries have been fighting over their borders for thousands of years, and we would be obligated to send U.S. troops to fight one Bosnia after another.
NATO expansion might not be the worst U.S. foreign policy initiative of the 20th century, but it definitely ranks in the top three or four.
Ted Galen Carpenter is a vice president for foreign policy at Washington's Cato Institute and has written extensively about NATO policy.
It would antagonize Russia, possibly leading to a Russian-Chinese alliance. It would undermine pro-Western Russian Democrats. It would create security commitments that we could not fulfill to the new East European members of NATO without a U.S. nuclear guarantee, and it would entangle us in any number of potential Bosnia-style crises in Central and Eastern Europe. It is a dreadful, potentially catastrophic idea.
The advocates of global governance are all around us. Public school textbooks are filled with concepts about world citizenship rather than American independence, about protection of the earth and biodiversity rather than human rights, and about definitions of the family to conform to the feminist consensus in Beijing and the UN treaties about women and the child. The National Education Association passes a resolution every year calling for global education in the schools. I received this letter from Walter Cronkite, the longtime icon of television news, asking me to contribute to the campaign for global change. He urged a global call for a reinvigorated United Nations, permanent UN peacekeeping forces, an international court, and a strong commission for sustainable development that would restrict our private property rights. Global treaties and conferences are a direct threat to every American citizen. They are an assault on your right to raise and educate your children as you see fit. They are an attack on your ownership of your private property and on American ownership of our national treasures, such as our national parks. They are an attack on your pocketbook, because if the UN ever gets taxing power, there's no limit to how much of our money it can grab. And they are an attack on the American standard of living, because their goal is to steal American wealth and redistribute it to the rest of the world. Global treaties and conferences are an assault on the soul and the sovereignty of America, because they mean that young American men and women will be sent around the world on phony peacekeeping expeditions. Our Declaration of Independence and United States Constitution are the fountainhead of the freedom and prosperity Americans enjoy. That freedom is threatened now. The price of liberty is eternal vigilance. It's time for Americans to be vigilant so that treaties and conferences do not steal our precious and unique heritage. That's why we produce this program, so that you and other Americans will know the truth, and together we will resist global governance. Watch for treaty votes in the U.S. Senate. Make your voice heard when it counts, and show this program to your friends. Truth is the best weapon against global governance.
What I'm seeing is an escalation of the takeover of command and control of our military, the takeover of a large portion of our land base, and the conquering of America's freedom and spirit of independence and self-reliance.
Whether we move left or right or center, the destiny of our country ought to be determined by Americans. And to see our own leaders surrendering that sovereignty to global institution, it seems to me eerily approaches a sellout and a betrayal of the founding fathers and of the idea for which America was founded.
I simply reject the notion that somehow we can go to countries where there is less freedom, less respect, less dignity for any affected population, whether it be women or children, and get them to tell us what we ought to be doing. I think as responsible individuals, given the capacity to make consequential choices by our government and ultimately by God who created us to be free, we don't need an international organization to tell us how to treat our children, how to treat ourselves, how to treat our women, how to fashion our families. As free Americans, we can make those decisions right here at home.